Please join us in welcoming
Maura Conlon.
Month, I had this most surreal experience. I was standing in line at the grocery store and I noticed on the cover of Rolling Stone magazine, full spread, was a picture of Pope Francis. Like, I guess they call him the rock and roll Pope, and the, you know, he's like this. And then right below his picture was this headline that said, "The times, they are a-changing." And I thought, oh, wow. Well, what was surreal about it is, like, in that moment, I saw my picture on the cover of Rolling Stone, like this. And but instead, the headline read, "The times, they kind of changed 30 years ago when I left the Catholic Church." And ever since that time, I have to say, as the years have rolled along, I have been filled with a sense of rawness or like a sadness that I felt compelled to leave the religion of the family, my family's origin. Because the thing is, when I was a kid, I loved going to church. I'd go with my mom and my siblings to St. Hedwig's Church in Southern California. And my mother knew I loved to sit next to the stained glass windows. And so she always chose the pew that was right next to the stained glass. And the moment I sat down, when the church services started, my head just kind of got pulled to the stained glass because the colors were so illuminating. I felt like God had dressed up as sunshine and was coming at me through all those panes so that he could pay a personal visit to me. And I would just sit there and watch the purples pop and the blues and the golds. And it's like all the colors were having a conversation with each other. I felt like, well, if they say Jesus is the light, well then Jesus is right here because look how light this window is. And why are all those adults looking up there someplace? So I would just stay looking at the stained glass. And when the light would change, that beautiful California light, the reds would kind of glow more intense, the yellows, and then I would look at my hands, and then some of the colors coming through the stained glass, some of the colors would actually like be little flecks on my skin. So it was like little holy flecks. And I felt like the holy fleckled child. And I thought, God, this is like so amazing. Then there was the smell of the incense and the choir, and I thought, oh my God, this is so much better than Gilligan's Island. I love this. I can't wait to come back next Sunday. So that's how I spent my church Sundays when I was 7 or 8. But of course, you know, childhood, a lot of our good times end when we start to come of age. Right? Yeah. And my mother, being the good Catholic woman that she was, said it was time for me to become a soldier of Christ and prepare for my confirmation ceremony, which was like initiation to go from childhood to adulthood. I mean, to me, it was sort of like really a ceremony. It was about not, you know, telling us that we are not going to have premarital sex. But in any event, so we, you know, go through this whole ceremony. But the purpose of it really was to learn to become like a serious adult Catholic and no longer like that child who like stayed with the light. And so I did my best. So I would sit in my seat, and what I was supposed to do was like way up to the altar and pay attention to what the priest was doing. And I tell you, it was so different than sitting with the light right here on me, because the altar was so far away and it was dark. And then hanging above the priest was a crucifix with Christ on it, you know, sort of there like this. I mean, I don't know if I need to describe it. But let's just say between the crown of thorns and the blood dripping here, it was like a different feeling inside than looking at the light. But I thought, well, this is what adult Catholics do. So I, you know, I'm just like, pay attention, focus on that. And then my mom said, listen to the readings, listen to the Gospels, listen to the epistles. This is a part of becoming an adult in your faith. And so I kept listening week after week, Sunday after Sunday. And I started to get kind of like cognitive dissonance, because so many of the readings were written by men whose names I could not pronounce, and they were written like 2,000 years ago. And so I was trying to figure out how those connected to like my life, where I stood in this church 10 miles from Disneyland and like 3 miles from the ocean. And then what happened after that was, I mean, it's kind of embarrassing to admit, but I would be in a pew and I would get this heavy feeling in my heart, and it was like this energy that was starting to rise up, like up my throat. And I started to fear that I was going to develop like this Tourette syndrome and start yelling out to the priest up there, why the heck does Virgin Mary have to be a virgin? Or things like, I don't know, if Jesus Christ like died and then rose, well then why are we still keeping him on the cross like 2,000 years later? I know we're not supposed to talk about religion on Saturday nights. So this was increasing angst in me, and I decided I would bring it to my mother's attention. And so I told her I was just feeling so confused about my faith and what was I supposed to do. It didn't make that much sense to me. And she just said, you know, Maura, faith is not meant to be understood. It's a mystery. You just accept it. It's a beautiful thing. You accept it. Right here. You know, Jesus founded the Catholic Church, and he bequeathed it to Peter. And it's come all the way down to us, through all the popes, through all the centuries, all the, you know, and then it's a gift for you to celebrate life with. It's a beautiful gift. So I said, okay, it's a gift. All right, so I would go back to church and, sit in the pew and trying to just stay focused on everything so I could be a good adult Catholic and follow the faith of my family. We had two uncles who were priests and an aunt who was a nun. I mean, there was like no questioning what church we came from. And then one Sunday, it just all kind of blew apart because Father Grimm, we'll call him Father Grimm to kind of protect his identity, even though I'm sure he's no longer with us. But he got up on the podium when it was time to address the audience or the congregation, and he was kind of scary looking. I mean, he was sort of like this, and he had his bony finger, and he sort of leaned out to us. And he told us, you're all a bunch of liars, and cheaters, adulterers, and philanderers, and robbers, and you steal each other's televisions, don't you know? I mean, I just knew that was not right. I mean, that was not the gift of faith that my mom was talking about. So I went home, and I wrote a letter to Father Grimm. And I was a very contained child. I was very shy, actually. I got the most quiet girl award in ninth grade. But I just couldn't stand it. It just didn't seem right. I mean, I've been stained glass with the light and love and Jesus, like right here, and then he's up here saying all these horrible things. I mean, the purpose of religion, I thought, was about how to help us live a better life, how to become more loving people. So I wrote that in my letter to Father Grimm. And I sent it off to him thinking, well, that's the end of that. At least I got that off my chest. Well, I didn't know priests could actually call people in their parish. Because 3 days later, their phone rings, and it's Father Grimm. And he tells me that I'm going through a time of spiritual weakness. That I'm to come to the rectory for emergency spiritual counseling. And how dare I challenge what he has to say? Well, I was shaking in my boots when he was saying those things to me on the phone. And when I hung up, I said to myself, I'm never going in for spiritual counseling. Ha 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 ha. thing is, I felt spiritually strong. I was 17 years old. I saw the divine in sunsets, in the trees, the shape of the limbs. I saw the divine in flowers and the ocean, in people. I mean, I was even seeing the divine in animals, which was pretty amazing because, like, we had no dogs in our family. And that was like the moment in my life where I kind of went from, you know, checkbox if you're a Catholic to checkbox if you're, you know, secular or spiritual or like something else. It was just a real coming of age moment. So eventually, you know, time went on and I left the house. I got a career. I moved to different parts of the country with my career. And sometimes I would come home and I would see my mom and, you know, she would say, well, you know, she was very sort of subtle. And she'd say, well, so have you found a parish that you like, that new town that you're living in? And there was just this huge wedge between my mother and I. And I just looked at her and just kept quiet. And my quiet grin just kind of spelled out in calligraphy, done. Don't need it anymore. Done. So as the years went on, my mother approached her 70s. I was probably close to my early 40s, and I got a call one day. She told me that she had developed the diagnosis of cancer. And so I knew it was time to come home and spend more time with her. And so I would. I would fly home to California from whatever town I was living in. I think I was actually up in Eugene at that point. And I would go to her chemotherapy sessions with her. And afterwards, we'd go to the beach. She loved just to sit at the beach and just watch the ocean and watch the sunset and listen to the waves crash. And sometimes like a surfer would go by and they would kind of like, you know, wave to her because she apparently came to the beach so often that they all recognized her Ford LTD car. And I thought, wow, you know, my mom knows surfers. I mean, that's pretty amazing. So I was sitting there one day with her and she said, well, I was wondering if you wouldn't mind going to St. Anne's Church with me on the way home. And right then, the wedge just kind of went like this into my heart. And I, my mother is in her last probably 6 months of life. And what am I about to say? No, I refuse to go. So I said, sure, Mom, I'll go with you to St. Anne's. That's fine. Yeah, that's no problem. You know, it's just a couple blocks away. But in my mind, I'm like, oh my God, I know what's going to happen. We're going to open the doors. There's going to be a gauntlet of priests, you know, ready to do like save your souls, last minute Catholic intervention program. So I don't burn in hell. My mother can someday die in peace. And so, but I was like kind of getting ready for that. So we drive St. Anne's Church from the beach. And St. Anne's Church was actually where I got married, in Seal Beach, California, just a couple blocks from the ocean. And we entered the big brass doors in front of the church. And I kind of prepared myself for what I was going to face inside. And I knew I would take it on because my mother was in her last months of life. So I opened the brass doors, and then my mother walked. And I walked behind her. And I looked up. There was nobody in the church. Nobody in the church. What the hell are we doing here? There's nobody in the church. I thought, well, we'll at least walk up the center aisle and my mom will want to sit at the pew and, you know, say some prayers to God. But instead, she grabs my arm and she takes me to a side wall of the church where all the stained glass windows are. And we walk to one stained glass window. And there's a silence. I look at it, just like I remember the stained glass windows from my childhood. And sure enough, that California sun is roaring on through. God coming in as sunshine.
The reds are just so deep red popping, and the purples are wiggling, and the golds and the yellows, and it's almost too much in a way to be in front of it. And my mother just looks at me and says, I just need to tell you something. And I said, she points to one pane. It's the color of tangerine. Same color tangerine lipstick she wore her entire life. And it's just swirling with light. It's just vibrating. She says, I just want you to know that I love this color. I didn't know what to say. And it took me time, actually, to realize that my mom was actually standing in her own shoes and telling me that she had had that same divine connection all along. That she was a poet of light. So even though I might be a Rolling Stone, far away from the Catholic Church, I'm grateful for those stained glass windows. The stained glass windows of my youth. And that beautiful stained glass window where my mother and I sat upon 10 years ago. Thank you.